A double dose of debauchery as we begin our tyrant series with Caligula and our Bible story series with Sodom and Gomorrah. Watch these tyrants and Bible stories get deep, fat, fried.
Deep, fat, fried.
And welcome to a sad episode.
Unfortunately.
Of Deep Fat Fried.
Yeah.
You know, we've had it.
I'm kind of out of the loop. Why is it sad again?
Oh, you know.
You
Scotty.
Know why, Sky. Come on, don't be coy. Don't listen.
Don't play coy with the audience. It's kind of a solemn time.
It's a somber day.
Sad day.
As you all know, the Deep Fat Fried podcast is coming to a fucking end. You know, we had a good run, guys.
We really did. I mean,
and look, the interpersonal differences have just forced us apart. Paul and Scotty are going their own separate way to do the Suffocating Retards podcast.
I thought it was a salt cast.
Actually, I heard it was going to be called The Menstrual Show.
The Menstrual Show, yes.
Oh, really?
Yes.
And I'm going to go off and do my own podcast, The Prolapsed Anus Cast.
But let's, look, we don't want to shill that shit, you know, because we really are here.
I do. I want people to tune in to my new Prolapsed Anus Cast.
Well, I want to remember all the amazing times that we had here on Deep Fat
Fried. You know what?
I mean, one thing that we can say is we left absolutely nothing on the fucking floor.
And we know a lot of the fans out there are sad. We're going to do this one last episode for you guys, but, you know, it's time to call it quits.
I mean,
and we have this beautiful tribute to all that we've accomplished
here. Let's
see
this beautiful tribute.
Let's watch.
This is just a little clip show of some of the finest moments.
All right, TJ, enough
of that.
Fried. Without further ado, come on, let's just play this, man. It's hard enough.
Night, a heartwarming story of triumph as one man overcomes his disability of being completely unfunny to rise as one of the most successful comedians in American history. Tonight, Timothy Allen Dick gets deep, fat, fried.
I mean, you're talking about not funny, too. You know what else is not funny? When you go into the grocery store and you, you know, you come back out and you find that there's a ding in your door and you're like,
The laughter. The tears.
Hey. What the fuck?
Wow, guys, we had a great run here on this show, and I just want to say
TJ, if you start crying, I swear to fucking God, I'm going to start crying.
It's been an honor.
That's why I'm
going to
make fun of you both.
To work with both of you guys.
Shut
on
up,
this
man.
Project.
You know what? We have one more show to do, TJ. We have one more show to do.
One last show.
And you know what? It's got to be just as good as the other show.
You guys just want to.
I don't know how it could be any worse with fucking TJ here.
That's true.
You guys just want to get back together.
Okay, yeah, let's get back together.
All right, DFF.
Fuck this minstrel show shit.
Well,
let's just do DFF another couple
DFF
episodes.
DFF for life.
Well,
at least, you know, a couple more episodes.
I'm willing to sign for two more episodes.
Well, let's review, TJ, how we started this episode like Caligula, right? And you're like, yeah. I'm like, do you have a run sheet or anything? And you're like, nah, it's pretty self-explanatory. We'll just wing it. So this is
you guys will be fine.
You guys will be fine. I'm not hanging out to dry or anything. You know Roman history at the back of your hand, don't you? Wait a moment. Oh, we're going live. Sorry. We're not live, but whatever. You know what
we're
I mean.
We're going live. I see now that this doesn't quite fit.
I feel like we're live, but it's just, you know, years of being like, when we're doing this format, you know, not this format, but just being, you know, doing a fucking show, and it's like, we're live. It's like, oh, we're not live? Never mind.
Yeah, I don't even...
So we can cut this all out. This whole thing could just be on the fucking cutting room floor. We can make ourselves look better than we actually are, and not. I won't make stupid mistakes like that. I'll just be like, edit that out.
Bring jump cuts to Deep Fat Fry. Yeah. That's what we need.
Doing a quick,
just jump
lightning
cut.
Fast jump cuts. Every episode's 15 minutes, even though we recorded
an hour
and a half.
Dude, fuck that. 15 seconds.
Yeah.
Deep Fat Fry!
Deep Fat Fry! Man, Caligula was crazy.
Yeah.
The Bible's nuts.
Whoa.
See you next week.
Bye, guys.
Classic moments.
Dude, we should We should fucking release like 15-second fucking explanations of episodes. Like, that'd be awesome, dude. Like, here's the episode summed up. It's crazy. Watch.
It's a crazy episode, man. You ain't even gonna believe it, man.
You ain't gonna believe what happened on Deep Fat.
Boy,
you
ain't gonna believe. Talk about that there Caligula, man.
Caligula.
Yeah, I'm a Caligula.
Excuse me, I'm here to take picture of statue of Caligula.
Oh, statue to cover.
Oh, look at statue of Caligula. I take big picture to send home to family.
Here's a colorized one.
Ooh.
Ooh, he's pretty. Oh, you're pretty, sweetie.
He's so pretty.
I think that's probably pretty flattering. I don't think Caligula was that traditionally good looking.
They said his hair was really thin. So
yeah, so he's
they
bald.
They gave him a big, thick
mane.
Yeah.
Yeah, of course.
You know how that goes, though.
Well, I mean, of course they're going to make him look better.
You
got to
burp in the mic a lot. The fans love that.
Thanks, TJ.
If the emperor commissions a statue, it's not like he's going to be like, make me have a fucking pot belly and balding
right.
hair.
Depict me as fucking unflatteringly as possible.
Yeah.
I want to look like an ugly turd history.
Me and TJ went to Rome, and like seeing the statues, like, they're pretty, most of them are pretty impressive, the ones we saw, but like, yeah, they're definitely done in the light of that this emperor is going to make himself look as good in his regal. And is, you know, leaderly
people
as
didn't really have a good fucking idea what they looked like anyway back then, you know?
I guess that's maybe why I don't have a good mentality to be an emperor, because, like, I would want, like, if somebody's going to do a marble statue of me, I'd want it to be down to the gnat's ass, dude. I wouldn't want to leave something behind of me that didn't look like me.
Well, who knows? So we have a little bit of an early biographical thing about Caligula.
All right. Well,
this is not Caligula.
not Caligula.
That's not him.
Holy shit. He looks a lot like...
Woo! He was evil as shit.
Yeah. Very ominous the way this is presented. Jesus.
Not very unequivocal in their... Their treatment of Caligula.
No.
The most evil men in history.
The most menacing intro.
While we're doing research, we found one that was 1,400 days of terror.
Yeah. Crazy.
1,400 days.
One thing
of
you have to
terror.
Understand about Discovery and History Channel when they cover subjects like this is, especially the Roman emperors like Caligula and Augustus Caesar, and you know, especially the emperors that are later on, a lot of this shit was gossip. You know, I mean, we're gonna get more into that.
Fucking gossip.
But you have to take a lot of this ancient history with a grain of salt. You can't just look. So
you gotta take anything from the History Channel with a grain of salt.
This is from the Discovery Channel.
They're reputable.
Well, a lot of the source of this information comes from a guy named Suetonius, who lived about 80 years, I think, or something. You said, Paul, after.
Yep.
See, you do know Roman history like the back of your
hand. Well, we looked into it.
We looked into it.
Fucking do this show, TJ. I
was being fucking facetious, TJ. I wasn't like we didn't prepare at all. Like, Caligula.
You weren't being facetious, guy.
He was
we'll get into whether or not Caligula
Italian?
Deserves his reputation.
Yeah,
when
we'll
Caligula
get into that.
Caligula became emperor, there were celebrations in Rome.
Of course.
It was seen as a new golden age after the dark years of Emperor Tiberius.
My name is James Tiberius Kirk.
But Caligula would lead a life.
Well, people felt that Tiberius was kind of like, they said basically, one of my research, that Augustus Caesar, who was basically the nephew of Julius Caesar, who had reigned for a long time, Tiberius was not really his first choice. He was just the only living heir, I guess, for someone that at that point that he basically wanted to pass down the throne to.
And Tiberius was a piece of shit that everybody hated him.
Yeah, he basically retired to an island. He didn't really want to be emperor. He wasn't well liked or well loved. So not really the best choice for emperor. But he kind of just he was in power.
You know what? You can say what you want about Tiberius, but I'm a big Tiberius fan, dude.
You like Tiberius?
Oh, okay.
Big fan of Tiberius,
well,
dude.
I'm more into Caligula.
Caligula.
Well, Caligula is way more remembered.
Well, maybe we'll do Tiberius in a future episode of our tyrant series.
This dynasty in the Roman Empire was called the Julio-Claudian dynasty. Which starts with Augustus.
La-di-da.
La-di-freaking-da.
And I forget who it ends with, but I think...
Doesn't even know who it ends with.
Did it end with Caligula, actually?
Stupid fuck.
Or did it keep going?
No, because they passed the reins to, like, his uncle
Claudius.
Or something after that.
Oh, that's true.
And brutally murder for fun.
Awesome. He sounds like a cool guy so far.
So far, TJ has no problems.
He reveled in killing his victims slowly and painfully.
Whoa. Fuck yes. Yeah.
Caligula forced families to attend their children's executions.
Cool.
Possibly.
His sadism horrified an empire.
His whole aim in life as emperor was to explore the...
Listen to this lesbian. She knows what she's talking about.
He seems to have found the exercise of power...
And this one, too. Why are both the experts lesbians?
Well,
I don't know.
If you listen what they say, I thought it would be an interesting fucking springboard. Like, they say that he was, like, kind of driven by this idea.
Let them
test.
Speak for themselves, man.
Well, you've talked over them.
And the desire to oppress other people. Very tempting.
Wow, that was very insightful.
Yeah.
I mean,
that's the thing, though. Like, what do you think you would be like if put in the position of an emperor?
Basically Caligula.
So you would immediately fall to that.
I mean, I don't know about immediately, but, you know, within a couple of years or two.
I see you as more of a Nero.
Whatever.
I just,
power corrupts is the point.
Absolute
right?
power corrupts,
but
absolutely.
Also, a lot of the history of these emperors, especially the ones that weren't popular, was basically written by the aristocracy of the time. This is the people that they were all vying for power. They wanted to be the emperor. They wanted to have
control. It was like Game of Thrones is back then.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. So, but the emperor consolidated power at the top, so of course... All the stories about the emperor is going to be shit like, you know, he's a piece of shit. I mean, I think a lot of it we're just reading.
You guys hear about the emperor? Total douchebag.
Well, it's propaganda, basically. You know, he watched children, you know, children were made to watch their parents get executed. He appointed,
another thing is
a horse to the Senate.
If you put that in the context of Rome, I mean, it's really not that crazy because, I mean, they had a huge slave labor force, and cruelty was kind of just the order of the day.
Right. I mean, so it's not like this super peaceful time, and then suddenly this bloodthirsty tyrant Caligula descends from the fucking sky,
Rome,
starts reaping the souls of
Rome was
innocence.
A civilization built
they liked
on warfare.
To, they liked to, yeah, they were all about war and conquest, and when they didn't like someone, they crucified them. They fucking had blood sports. As their entertainment.
Well, Rome basically had a policy of what it would do was it would basically offer you a really good deal, like, hey, if you surrender, just do what we want and become like, you know, a client state of ours or something.
They had
we'll treat you well, but if not, yeah, it was just totally brutal.
We'll just
empire.
Exterminate.
Yeah,
you.
We'll kill you.
You know, they had events at the Colosseum, like it's like, oh, today at the Colosseum, we're gonna show 100 virgins getting raped, and it was just like, yeah, good entertainment.
Well, yeah, you know, it's actually funny. People talk about gladiators being killed, but a lot of them are actually valuable. But slaves or animals or other things like that, that's really, or prisoners, that's what you would see normally killed because they had no value. But a gladiator actually had value to someone, the Lannisters, who actually had the gladiators.
Now, when Caligula,
they invested money in them.
When
Caligula
first came to power, he was actually pretty popular. That's what this next clip is about.
Sure.
So let's listen to that.
The wave of popularity.
Tiberius named his joint successors, Caligula and Gemellus. Were to rule together. It would never happen.
Tiberius
Didn't happen. Died in March 37. Guided by Macro, the Senate threw out his will on the grounds of insanity. They handed sole control of the empire to Caligula. The new emperor was just 24 years old.
That's another thing. Like,
that's
crazy. It's not even like this dude had like the age and wisdom and maturity to be handed this.
Can you imagine you at 24 being handed ultimate fucking power over the known world?
But you have to look at the Roman mindset at the time. I mean, they had the time right before with Julius Caesar, with Pompey. They had civil war. They had civil strife for so long, and I don't think anyone wanted to return to that. And I think that's a lot of times why you had these dictatorships form and these tyrants come about, because they said, look, we can have this person who is from a popular family. They're going to bring stability. They're going to bring the peace that we need to have for the commerce. So this all just keeps working, because if not, then all these other families are going to come out. All these factions are going to fight for who's going to be on top. But if they just appoint somebody from an already established bloodline, which is what they were going by at the time, then it's just kind of simple.
Well,
it makes the transition a lot smoother.
He was a descendant of Caesar.
Yeah, of Julius Caesar and Augustus
Caesar.
His
actual name was not Caligula. It was Gaius Julius Caesar Augustus Germanicus.
Yes.
Fucking crazy.
What a fucking mouthful. His father...
I wish I had a name like that, man.
His father was a guy named Germanicus, who was a popular Roman general who was probably killed, or at least... There was rumors that he was killed by Tiberius because he was so popular that he threatened the popularity of Tiberius. Tiberius is like, this guy could potentially seize control from me. He died. The way he died had a lot of the telltale signs of poisoning. Caligula's family, his mother, probably egged on by all these crowds of people telling her Tiberius did it, went out and publicly said Tiberius had Germanicus killed. So, of course, Tiberius killed her. He sentenced the brothers of Caligula to prison. And they basically died of starvation in different prisons. And she died of starvation.
Sounds like a real peaceful time to inherit the fucking throne.
His mother died of starvation, confined to some island. And then later on, Caligula actually was brought into the inner circle of Tiberius, where he kind of had to kiss Tiberius's ass, knowing that this is the guy who had his whole family murdered.
Right.
So he basically had to supplicate himself and suck it up and act like he was cool with this guy who had, you know, murdered his whole fucking family. So I imagine that probably had some pretty big... impact on the psyche of Caligula. By the way, Paul, do you want to tell him what Caligula actually means? Because it's kind of funny.
Yeah, it means little boot.
Yep, little boots. The reason for that is because when Germanicus was out there doing his soldier thing, Caligula's mother would dress him up as a little soldier, and they would call him Little Boots, all the other soldiers. And
yeah, it was like a PR stunt.
Yeah.
She thought it would be cool for them to see, like, this person with such a noble bloodline, so young, with a soldier's uniform. It was used, like, you know, trot out the kid.
Oh, yeah.
His mother's name was Agrippina.
But yet again, it's kind of very telling about Roman culture. It's, you know, it's the military is such a big thing. I mean, that's why there's always so many parallels I think people draw from the U.S. and from Rome.
So he kind of started life as a showbiz kid then.
You know, there really wasn't...
And his showbiz name was Caligula, the Little Boots. And hey, Little Boots!
Not a name he liked, by the way, but still one that stuck.
Yeah.
Clearly, I mean, we're talking about this 2,000 plus years later.
Shortly after he... was handed the... Well, let's just watch the rest of this video first. Let's just see how this, where this is going.
Highly strung, he was tall and spindly, with sunken eyes and thinning hair. Later in his reign, he was to order men with thicker hair to shave their heads.
So very insecure.
For now, Rome was elated.
Who knows?
Who can blame him? I mean, he grew up as a fucking little entertainment kid. You know, he was Little Boots, man, and but, then I all mean, that went away.
I mean, yet again, that kind of reeks of more a political attack. You know, he ordered men with thick hair to shave their head. Maybe, you know,
maybe
like
he did.
But I mean, that almost even seems petty for that. I mean, like if you have that much power over people,
or maybe some later fucking noble that you know fucking had interest in defaming the Julian dynasty decided to make Caligula some weirdo that made people shave their heads. It's hard to know.
The greeted him. Were quite extraordinary. And he was greeted in the same way by the Senate. Everything went absolutely smoothly. They were falling over themselves to welcome him.
Well, that seems plausible. I mean, you know, when someone new rises to power, especially from an influential and powerful
yeah,
family.
Tiberius
was basically
a shit
heel. The Obama of his time.
Yeah.
Change,
because,
dude.
Change.
Because they were just coming off a very unpopular leader who had made a lot of unpopular decisions, who a lot of people considered very stingy. You know, Tiberius, the Roman people, they loved their games and their spectacles and their sports. Tiberius didn't want to shell out the cash for that because he didn't really like the people. He didn't really care about the people.
Didn't even want to be emperor, really.
He was super paranoid. He held all these treason trials and stuff, constantly having his political opponents killed, which was, like I said, pretty standard at the time, but obviously not popular. So Caligula was kind of viewed as like, ooh, a breath of fresh air. He's going to be different. He's going to be change. And
I'm Caligula. I'm gonna drink your blood. I'm going to rape your wives. I'm going to sleep with my sisters.
There really wasn't, honestly, too much of an indication that Caligula was a bad guy in any sense at first. I mean, like, the first part of his reign was characterized by an extended celebration. He brought back a lot of the big spectacles and games that the Roman people loved so much. You know, it was all about celebrating. He actually spent a ton of the Roman, the Rome's money on
basically the Roman treasury's money on, you know, games. And, well, I mean, he wanted to please the Roman mob. He wanted to please people that before had been so unhappy. And I think, you know, as a new leader, that's probably what he'd been advised to do. It's like, look, you know, Tiberius came before you, was unpopular. I'm going to undo this. And he obviously, like you said, he probably did a lot of those decisions if he really did hate him. You know, if he had his family members killed, it's like, well, I want to undo these policies. I want to really win over people and show them I'm really different.
Well, it was kind of about a year or maybe a little less into his reign. Caligula fell ill. And it was really after that that he was never quite the same. And we'll take a look at a clip pertaining to that.
The first 6 months of Caligula's reign were a period of euphoria. They came at a price. In just 12 months, Caligula ran through 2.7 billion sesterces, enough to pay the army for 8 years. But the golden days of fun had taken a greater toll on his health. Before the summer was over, he suffered a physical and mental breakdown. Caligula's condition sent shockwaves through Rome. Desperate for his recovery, one high-ranking Roman offered to fight gladiators if the emperor survived. Caligula did, but he was a changed man.
Yeah, they might have wished him not to fucking survive.
So, when he came back...
That's when he kind of became the prick that history remembers him as.
He became more suspicious, more apt to kill...
You remember the guy they were talking about earlier that had kind of helped Caligula come to power? It was a general named Marco or Marcus or something along those lines. Don't quite remember his exact name, but I think it was Macro, actually.
Macro. Yeah,
it was Macro. He actually had him killed in short order. A lot of the people that actually engineered Caligula's rise to power, he became very suspicious of them. And they kind of thought maybe it was because he was offended that when he was sick and on death's door, he saw the process of, you know, them preparing already for the next thing. He didn't like the idea of being replaced. He didn't like the idea of people moving on from his reign.
So when he saw that happening around him as he was maybe dying, he was kind of driven when he came back from that to get rid of the people that were engineering that next thing.
Well, that shows you kind of a fundamental misunderstanding of how he rose to power, because he did obviously he needed the support of these people. Like you said, Macro. I mean, all these people obviously propped him up, and he obviously at that point had been selected to be emperor. I mean, they could have picked a lot of other people. It was just he had the right bloodline, he had the right pedigree, he had the right things going for him.
Right.
So, I mean, at that point, when you start killing your top supporters, that's obviously going to send shockwaves because people are going, who can really trust this person?
Yeah, I mean, it'd be like if we had a president now that was just constantly firing members of his cabinet and... Oh, wait, sorry.
Making outrageous statements over Twitter, you know, threatening nuclear war.
Is Trump the modern-day Caligula kind of?
If he proclaims himself a god, he will be. If he comes, he's like, look, I'm Jesus. I'm Jesus Christ. I'm literally Jesus. Like, if that happens, he'll be Caligula.
Then we can officially say Trump is the new Caligula.
Yep.
Okay. Just good to know.
Well, he did want to... Well, you know what? Instead of the sister, he's going for his daughter, though.
Yeah. You got the incest thing.
Mm-hmm.
You got Caligula was into freaky shit. There was that rumor about Trump liking to get pissed on.
Yep.
Trump likes pee-pee.
Trump liked the pee-pee.
I read a story today in the Washington Post that some porn star was paid $130,000 to keep her mouth shut just before the campaign started.
Interesting.
About who knows what. But why would you pay a porn star $130,000?
Maybe she was starring in the new line of Trump porn.
Maybe.
Listen, I know porn, and Trump porn is the best porn. I don't know exactly what this clip is, but I'm just going to go ahead and play it. This is called Caligula's Purge. Do you remember what this is about,
Yeah,
Paul?
This is when what we're talking about, when he started to
kill. Okay, so this is when he started turning on his
supporters. After his illness.
Yep.
So let's take a little quick look.
Caligula's purge was indiscriminate. Throughout his reign, the emperor took a keen interest in inflicting death.
Neat.
He issued precise instructions. Prisoners should be killed slowly by a series of small cuts. Executioners were told victims must feel their deaths.
Caligula's evil shows in his desire to make people suffer. We're told that he was torturing a man for so long that his brains began to putrefy and to smell.
Another victim claimed
he was innocent.
The execution was stopped. Caligula ordered soldiers to cut out his tongue. Then they killed him. The emperor was often present, even dining during the ordeal.
So, like, this is
dinner and a show.
So this is where you really get into the sensationalized parts of this. Like, the emperor probably had a lot of people killed. My dad, he was sitting there like, kill them in front of me while I dine on a succulent
hen.
Well,
how do you know?
I mean, yeah.
He might have been doing that.
He might have been. I don't know. I'm not saying that. Like, I'm just saying I take a lot of these things with a grain of salt. I'm sure any dictator is going to want to consolidate power and kill their political enemies and kill those who they feel have done them wrong or done them harm because, of course, they have the
you
power
to do
so. You
sound like a fucking Caligula apologist, Scotty.
I mean, I'm pretty sure he's
Caligula
far from
did nothing. Wrong.
Look, you know what, TJ? I'm just saying.
What about all the good things Caligula did, huh?
He did do some good things. He did public works, TJ. He built some temples. He was doing things in his time.
What about
I'm saying
Caligula.
I mean, as far as dictators go,
why don't you go suck Caligula's dick, Scotty?
Well, he's dead, so I can't.
Why don't you go suck Caligula's fat fucking
cock? Build me a fucking time machine, bitch, and I will.
Oh, you know Caligula's not dead, dude. Caligula lives on within us all.
He lives on inside us.
Caligula licked them balls.
Also insisted the victims' families join him.
Cool. Hey, you want to come watch your family die?
Yeah. Caligula sent a letter. I like these actor portrayals. He's like, yeah, come sit down. Oh, look at it. Oh, yeah, yep. Oh, your kid's dead. Oh, look at him. Oh, he's dead. Oh.
Look at his head roll.
Oh, look at him. Oh, you're weeping. Oh, that's so sad.
Aw. Such a sad day
looks
for you,
like he's
huh,
not,
buddy?
Looks like he's not going home to the wife and kids now. Yeah. Oh.
Some dude, like right there at the end of that video, it says that some dude said he was too sick to attend his son's execution. So Caligula sent a fucking bunch of people with a litter to carry him in there so he could watch his son.
Jesus.
Die.
There you go.
To his house to collect him.
Yeah.
As Caligula indulged his sadism to the hilt, members of the Senate even found themselves ordered into the gladiator's ring.
Damn.
Cool. That'd be like
Trump.
You
know, we need to kind of bring that back, honestly. Yeah. That'd be kind of cool.
Man, I don't know, dude. If Trump had that kind of power, he actually might have drained the swamp, dude.
Yeah. Anybody doesn't like Rens Priebus, you're going to the torture dome or some shit.
Torture dome.
You're gonna fight a grizzly bear, Rens. You want to be the head of the RNC. You got to be tough enough to fight a grizzly. So you're gonna fight a fucking bear, Rens.
Well, political deadlocks.
I'd watch.
Political deadlocks to be a thing of the past. Just have the Democrat have one Democrat champion, one Republican champion. They fight to the death. Like okay, healthcare.
Every issue is decided by who can find the best gladiators.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Seems you'd have reasonable. All kinds of cool like technological gladiators and shit doing battle in the Death Dome.
We don't really have a video about this, but there is some stuff about Caligula's, Caligula's sex life is kind of a notorious subject.
Oh, yeah. For sure.
So first of all, he had a sister named Drusilla. Here's a little excerpt from an article. It is believed that he deflowered one of them, Drusilla, before he had assumed the robe of manhood and was even caught in her embraces by his grandmother, Antonia. Incest, although quite abhorrent for most Romans to perform, may have had a quite acceptable political motive. Both Hellenistic monarchs and the Ptolemy, is that how that's pronounced? Ptolemy? I don't know.
I think it's so.
dynasty where marriages between jointly ruling brothers and sisters, at the very least, Caligula could use this fig leaf reason to excuse his behavior. So he was a lot of these royal families throughout history have been really incestuous. That's why.
Way beyond the Romans too. Oh, yeah. That continued like all the way through the Habsburgs and the
Tsar. There was tons of hemophilia in the Russian royal family, and I think some other royal.
You have all these rare recessive traits because you have these very tight bloodlines. Especially in Europe. All these families were intermarrying.
No, it's not really one. I mean, like, a lot of this stuff, once again, comes from a historian called
Suetonius.
Yep. Who lived long after Caligula had died.
I think it's Suetonius and what's his name, like Dio or Dio or something?
Dio, yeah.
Dio has rocked.
There are some contemporary accounts of Caligula's reign. There are two, I think. I don't remember the names of the dudes, but. They don't mention a whole lot of the more sensational things about Caligula. That shit appears like 80 to 100 years after his death.
Yeah, and also a lot of this is lost to history. So I mean, to truly know a lot about his reign, I mean, we don't really know. There's a lot of gaps.
Another thing that Caligula liked to do.
What's that?
At least according to historians who wrote about it, was he really liked to cuck people.
Yeah.
He liked to cuck his enemies, or even just there was a story about him going to someone's wedding and basically stealing the bride and marrying her himself.
He had a fascination.
He divorced her 3 weeks later.
Women.
He liked to fuck. He liked to take the wives and, of his friends, rivals, whatever. And go off and take them into the next room and fuck the shit out of them and then come back and tell the husbands how they did in bed with him.
They were good. She was good.
Real good.
You picked
not great,
a good one.
But good.
Great piece of ass. No, I'm going to be honest with you. Great piece of ass. You did well.
That's how Caligula talked up.
Yeah, what if they came back and he was like, I mean, were they just put to death then?
No, he was like, I would kill you, but, you suffer enough with that fucking cold pussy.
And the knowledge that it was a great enough piece of ass, I might come back for a second piece anytime I want. All right? Have a nice married life, though.
Had a bunch of different... I think he had at least 3 marriages. He was always fucking different women. He really did seem to like to fuck women who were already spoken for. That was his thing. That was kind of his real kink.
So was it like bad for Caligula to show up at your wedding?
Yeah.
Were you like, oh shit, man, fuck, Caligula's here, shit. Man, he's going to spirit my fucking wife away and fuck her brains out for 12 hours and then return her to me a changed woman.
Well, I mean, unless you're a cock, I mean, then it's like, where's Caligula at?
Oh, yeah. I hope Caligula comes.
Emperor Caligula, may I watch in the cuck tent? I sit in the cuck tent and watch Caligula?
Did Caligula get an invite to the wedding? Is he coming? Is he coming, guys? Oh, he's not coming yet, though.
Just make sure your wife, tell her to fucking put some fake warts on and shit. You know, make Caligula show up, take one look, and go, eh.
Nah, I'm good.
He might just kill you out of fucking spite, though.
I mean, you wasted
I came
time.
All this way to get this pussy, and I didn't get nothing. Fuck this.
Just be like, fuck it, dude. I'm horny.
Yeah, Caligula might just be like, I don't give a shit how ugly she is.
It's not about what she looks like. It's about the fact that you think she's yours. Give her over.
I mean, obviously a sort of a dominance gesture there.
I mean, yeah, which is typified by the fact that he's a god, right?
Just everything about Caligula seems to speak to a very enormous ego.
Can you blame him?
No, I mean,
it's
his birth, he was told, you're great, you're going to accomplish great things, you're a fucking Caesar, your bloodline is the most impressive, greatest bloodline ever.
I don't see it that way.
Well, yeah,
and then they just hand him the reins of power.
I think that if he was little boots and he was dressed up in this fucking little uniform and trooped around, I think he was treated like a fucking prop for most of his life.
Probably.
He was like a little entertainment kid. And then he came of age. He's 20 fucking 4. Think of like Logan Paul was given ultimate power over the universe,
dude.
Oh,
God.
Think about it, though. That's basically what you're looking at. You're like a 20-year-old who's, grown up in the fucking entertainment industry where his job is to put a little soldier uniform on and traipse around with the troops and make them clap before his mom gives a big political speech. That's what his young life was like. That's how he got his nickname. So, like, and then all of a sudden he becomes this political chess piece because he's got this direct connection to the Caesars. And now he's got all this ultimate power. And his reign is this big blossoming golden age thing. Everybody treats it like it's the best thing because the guy that preceded him sucks. So immediately the ego is allowed to inflate to epic fucking proportions.
You know, one of the things about being an emperor of Rome at that time, Rome was a very militaristic society.
Completely.
I think they said at the time that Caligula came to power, I think it had a population of around 55 million. The land that it occupies now takes up something. I mean, there's like 40 something countries on that land today. So we're talking about a huge empire, huge population for that time. I think something like a third or a fourth of the world's entire population. And a lot of that was done through military expansion. Caligula came from a military family. His father, Germanicus, was a very popular general. Caligula's pedigree as being the son of Germanicus was a big part of what led him to power in the first place.
Well, yeah, I mean, when you look back, Julius Caesar was a general who rose to power. I mean, then his nephew, Augustus or Octavian Caesar, rose to power. He had to fight a war. I mean, so the military was a big part of Roman life. It was how people achieved power. They became generals. They had the acclaim of their soldiers and the people, and they used their power.
It was also kind of a barometer that the populace used to judge the popularity of their politicians. If you were out there conquering more territory for Rome, then you were doing your job.
Well, Caligula wanted to have that sort of military accolade. He really wasn't that type of person. And this next clip kind of talks about his triumph over an unconventional enemy.
Unlike his father Germanicus, Caligula was no soldier. But he believed he could exceed Germanicus's reputation and extend the empire into Britain. Caligula marched in comfort, accompanied by his troops and gladiators, crossing the German border early in 40 AD. After minor skirmishes, he fled in panic from an enemy attack.
Not the most impressive start.
Nope. Not a good start to your glorious military campaign.
Oh, minor skirmish, run!
Well, it's basically like, let's go take Germania. Fuck that, let's go to Britannia then. They fought back, so let's go to Britannia. Yeah, anybody for Britannia?
These Germanians are tough, guys. Let's go fight the Britannians.
Holy shit, they have axes over there. Did you see that guy? He had an axe. What is that? Who even fights with an axe? Let's go to Britannia.
Attention to Britain. What happened next defies military logic. On reaching the English Channel, Caligula set out to sea. But, as his biographer Dio reports, he promptly returned to shore.
Dio!
He took his seat on a lofty platform and gave the soldiers the signal as if for battle, bidding the trumpeters urge them on. Then, all of a sudden, he ordered them to gather up the shells. Caligula's elite forces picked up shells in their helmets. They were sent back to Rome for display as the spoils of victory over the ocean.
Victory
over the ocean.
Over the ocean.
What do you think the chances are that Caligula was just kind of like an anti-war person?
Tonight.
He was. Whoa.
Sorry.
Whoa.
What do you think? Like, he was anti-war, and he didn't want to continue this, like, constant warfare thing, so he did this stunt where he had them go conquer the sea by collecting all the seashells off the beach.
I think it's much more likely that he's like, I'm going to go conquer things. Yeah, I'm Caligula, bitch.
You think so? You think?
And then he was like, oh my God, these Germanians. Ah, run.
I think it's he just
Let's go to the Britannia.
Guy was stinky. Did you see that one guy? You could just tell. I mean, I was up on my fucking whatever the tower thing is they carry me on.
He lacked any military experience as well. I mean, he wasn't an experienced tactician. He didn't really understand.
He didn't understand.
I think he chickened out, and he's like, you know what? I beat the sea, guys.
Well, no, but think about this.
I triumphed over the ocean.
He basically went to the boundary of his empire.
Caligula won.
And then he realized, like, if I go any further, I'm going to have to actually pioneer this. I'm going to have to actually, like, summon this force within me to actually conquer these lands. And I don't think he had it within him to do that.
Clearly not.
Hi, guys. I conquered the ocean.
The ocean. Hey, ocean. I conquered you.
Ocean.
Soldiers.
Trust me. You don't even want those Germanians as part of your empire.
Let's
I went over
seashells.
There. They are disgusting. Oh, my God. Their hygiene is just so incredibly bad.
The fashion
Those Germanians
there.
Don't even bathe. Their hair is all greasy and ropey, and there was a dude, and he had an axe. Oh, my God. So I went to the beach, and I conquered the sea. Neptune, you're my bitch. I'm Caligula, and I've got all your seashells, motherfucker.
So it was shortly after that failure, or I guess that triumph over the ocean, if you choose to view it that way, that Caligula found himself dead.
Dead?
When he ordered his own statue to be placed in the Temple of Jerusalem, there was outrage in the Jewish population. It was the ultimate insult to the Jewish God. Fearing major riots, the local governor stalled, risking his own life. But before the statue was finished, the emperor was dead. Caligula had received dramatic proof that he was not divine. As he returned from the theater on the 24th of January 41 AD, Caligula was stabbed to death. The assassins included members of his family and the Praetorian Guard assigned to protect him.
So basically, the people who the other families that had power, Game of Thrones his ass. They were like, you know what? We thought Caligula would be something. We gave him a fucking shot.
Yeah, we thought he'd be a good puppet, but it turns out he's just kind of doing things that are making everybody look bad. So time to kill him.
Because
we've had enough.
Because when you think about a dictator, I mean, a lot of dictators are going to rule by proxy. They're not going to necessarily rule, make all these decisions themselves, because there's way too much administration. Rome had a huge bureaucracy. So it's really about the people who are managing the emperor. It's his advisors. So obviously at this point, they had lost all confidence in him. And of course, it was easy to dispose of him. The guards killed him. His own family members.
It was kind of a tradition in Rome by that time. Time to kill the emperor.
So they killed him. They killed his wife. And just to kind of underscore the brutality of the times in which Caligula lived, they actually smashed his only child, a 2-year-old daughter,
to death
against a wall until she was dead. And then I think that they passed the baton on to like his cowardly uncle or some shit.
Claudius.
Yeah, who was basically just a puppet of the military, and the military...
Well, that's what they wanted. Yeah. That's why Caligula got killed. I think the seashell stunt was the last straw.
I think so, too. I think that all the other stuff, like, oh, he killed his political opponents and did all this cruelty and shit,
I think
that was...
Yeah, they don't give a fuck about that.
Yeah, they don't care. They like that. That's fine.
As long as he's willing to do the military shit, because that's where the money gets made.
But when he was like, no, I want to collect seashells.
They were like, all right, we're not doing this.
Now, the seashell story might be apocryphal, in all fairness. But what is not apocryphal is that he did not conquer Britannia. He did not conquer Germania, whatever the fuck.
He really took a step that was antithetical to the values of the people he was ruling.
Yeah, when you live in a society that's built around conquest and you don't have the stomach for conquest, that's when your ass gets fucking stabbed and your wife gets stabbed and your daughter, who's 2 years old, gets fucking smashed against a wall.
If you're not prepared to expand the empire, are you fucking prepared to defend it? I mean, is that someone who you want to lead you when they're going to go collect seashells? Like you said, it might just be...
Yeah, it just makes you look weak.
It might just be the fucking, you know, sensationalized tale of something he did. But, I mean, obviously at that point, if he was assassinated, they lost confidence in
now,
him.
Now, we've kind of touched upon this a few times, but one of the things Caligula did that really offended people of his time was he did declare himself to be a god.
Yes, he did.
I think we actually have a clip from...
The movie.
From the movie Caligula, which we're going to talk about that in a little bit. In fact, it might be a good time. This might be a good segue into talking about the film a little bit. This is Caligula declaring himself a god.
shall wait for the unanimous decision of the Senate, Claudius.
All those who say aye, say aye.
So that's how they portrayed Claudius in this movie.
A fucking aye. Total dope, a yeah. Fucking buffoon.
Aye!
Sieg Heil!
He's a god now.
I don't think a bunch of dudes in a room being forced to call you a god necessarily makes you a god.
Well, I mean,
there's zero subtlety in a play like that anyways. I mean, there's other ways to declare yourself a god. I mean, if that's, I mean, obviously this is a fictionalized portrayal more than likely of how it happened, but
no, this is actually, they brought cameras back to...
No, wow. Fuck you, TJ.
He looks a lot like, what's his name?
They actually brought cameras back to...
They did.
You're a fucking piece of shit,
you
want to
fight about it, Scotty?
Caligula looks like a lot like the guy
in
Clockwork Orange, man. He looks a lot like...
Whoa.
Alex, yeah.
Maybe he's reincarnated. TJ did say they went back in time to film this.
Very similar character.
Who's that dude?
That is, his head looks like a cock. That.
Dick Hideous Germanicus Cock and Ballsicus.
Sheep.
Yeah, dude.
Sheep.
Isn't it great, dude? I love that.
Hey, Paul.
Yeah.
Deep fat fried.
Deep fat fried.
Wow.
Hey, audience. Do it with us, audience. Scotty, you don't seem very good at it.
I'm not really.
You're not a good sheep, Scotty.
Unfortunately, I'm not.
You must be a wolf in sheep's clothing.
Oh, shit. We found him.
The period of mourning is now over.
He's mad.
Bah. Yeah, get in there, sheep.
That was fun.
I love Caligula. I love the movie. It gets a lot of shit from a lot of people, but man, it's a fun movie to watch.
Do you want to talk a little bit about that movie, Paul?
Sure. It's at the time it was the most expensive indie film ever.
Yes.
So a super decadent production, basically.
Took 4 years to make.
Yeah, basically financed by Penthouse, the porn magazine.
It shows.
And it's based on a story by Gore Vidal, who's a really well-known playwright, scriptwrite, author,
who did not
intellectual.
Want to be even credited for it.
By the time it was done, he did not want his name on the film and actually sued the people that made the film afterwards his name removed.
Having seen this film and having read the reviews of the time, I mean, people thought it was just overly grotesque and obscene and just overly sensationally sexualized.
Well, that's like a lot of the movie was shot, and then afterwards, a bunch of porn was shot and injected into the movie.
Yeah.
The extended cut of the movie, the original cut, is like 154 minutes
long.
There is it's just unsimulated sex. In fact, there's
straight out porn.
There's actual childbirth in that movie. Here's one of the weirdest pieces of trivia. It's actually the very first piece of trivia you see on IMDb here. The childbirth scene where Cassonia gives birth was an actual childbirth, which was filmed in three takes using three different pregnant women extras and later edited together.
Wow. So they hired three actual pregnant women to give
it's
birth.
It's almost a miracle that a film this strange actually exists.
Yeah.
I'm impressed with their dedication to at least that part of the process. I mean, they actually got pregnant women to do that.
I mean, the sets in this movie are insane. The costume work is insane. Like, it's all over the top budget-wise. It's one of the most decadent, like, movies of the time in terms of expenditure.
That I more say enjoyed the movie. I don't think it's like an amazing film or anything, but I really enjoyed a lot of aspects of it.
No other fucking movie you can watch that's like...
It's nothing like anything you've ever seen.
I totally agree with that.
So you gotta get
probably unlike anything that will ever exist too. I doubt that anything like that will ever happen again.
Is this thing Caligula is angry also from that movie?
No, there's also another fictionalized portrayal of.
All right, well
Caligula.
Hold on. Let's not go to that.
All right,
yet. I want to instead. I want to read from a few excerpts from the Roger Ebert review. This is one of the more famous Roger Ebert reviews.
Okay.
I'm going to go ahead and read... I'm just going to read the beginning of it and the ending of it. And I'm not going to do the British accent because he was not fucking British. Paul.
Fuck you, TJ.
Story time with Paul.
Caligula is sickening, utterly worthless, shameful trash. If it is not the worst film I have ever seen, that makes it all the more shameful. People with talent allowed themselves to participate in this travesty. Disgusted and unspeakably depressed, I walked out of the film after 2 hours of its 170-minute length.
So I think that is he only did one time in his entire career.
Yes, that was on Saturday night as a line of hundreds of people stretched down Lincoln Avenue waiting to pay $7.50 apiece. By the way, standard movie ticket prices at that time were $3, so...
But the producers...
They were charging a huge amount of money premium. To see this movie. Yep. $7.50 apiece to become eyewitnesses to shame.
Wow.
He goes on to say later in the piece, I never had anything against eroticism in movies. There are X-rated films I've enjoyed. From the sensuous fantasies of Emmanuel to the pop comic absurdities of Russ Meyer. I assume the crowds lining up for the admission to the Davis Theater were hoping for some sort of erotic experience. I doubt they were spending $15 a couple for a lesson on the ancient history of Rome. Maybe not. But then they shouldn't have gone and seen a historical movie, I guess.
It's a movie about Caligula.
All right, so I'm going to just go ahead and skip to the end because this is where he fucking gets a little mean. The human being is a most curious animal, often ready to indulge himself in his base inclinations, but frequently reluctant to trust his better instincts. Surely people know, going in, that Caligula is worthless. Surely they know there are other movies in town that are infinitely better, yet here they are at Caligula. It's very sad. My friendly recommendation is that they see The Great Santini. Yeah, that's lived on and been immortalized.
Oh, yeah.
To freshen their minds and learn to laugh and care again in a movie. People learn fast.
I bet that movie's dog shit. I bet The Great Santini is a total fucking unwatchable, boring dog shit film, dude.
The movie, said the lady in front of me at the drinking fountain, is the worst piece of shit I have ever seen.
Wow.
So this is an example. This is probably one of Roger Ebert's most brutal reviews that he's ever done.
Yeah.
And honestly, I think
wholly unfair.
There's
a lot of
fucking people out there who really do detest this movie, but I've watched it and I think it's pretty goddamn enjoyable. It's not a great movie. It has its problems.
Yep. It's overlong.
It's fun.
Slow pacing.
But it is. It's fun.
It's crazy and it's fun and it's just a beautiful fucking display of over the top depravity.
Bah.
I say anytime you can go into a movie and you really, especially if you've seen a lot of movies like all of us have, and you can say, I don't think I've seen another movie like that. I think that is an achievement within itself, especially when it's not just random bullshit, when there actually is a story and there is a plot and there is things going on. Because I know it can make some random film where it doesn't have to make any sense and you'll just go, what does this mean? But this film, I think you understand it, and I think it really does. I think it captures the modern sensationalized version of Caligula really well.
So we're going to take a look at some clips from a TV show, correct?
Yeah, it's like
called
a TV series. Yeah, about it kind of chronicles Claudius's rise to power, but there's a portrayal of Caligula in it that's pretty interesting.
All right, let's take a look. I've never seen this.
We had thought that the streets might be strewn with flowers. He had thought that there might be messages to greet him, telling him of triumphs to be awarded. What did he find? This conqueror of the Germans, this victor of the mighty Neptune. The streets empty of crowds and flowers, no triumphs awarded, no games, no celebrations. But three miserable old ex-consuls waiting at the gates to greet him, and a room full of cowardly stay-at-home senators who spend all their time in the theater and at the baths, while he has spent 6 months living no better than a private soldier. Yes, your emperor has returned, but with this in his hand.
Oh.
Interesting, like a very blustery sort of fucking speech. He just comes in there.
Well, that was him talking about, you know, how there's no parades when he came back and brought all the seashells back.
Like, where the fuck is my celebration? It's like
no flowers.
Yeah, he wants his triumph.
You didn't conquer anything.
I conquered Neptune, bitch. Who are you? I'm Caligula. Who the fuck said that? Who was that?
Anyone could go get some seashells. So that was
John Hurt. I think in the Chamber's trail of Caligula. I think it really kind of captured, like you said, the essence there too.
We got one more clip from that same show, so we might as well just take a look at it.
This is a weird one. They kind of portray Caligula as pretty effeminate in this one. You might have been able to tell from that one. He's a little effete, but anyway.
Okay.
Okay, well,
and then she flits across the sky from star to star about. She lightens darkness where she flies. And
I just imagine being in an audience and like, watch the Emperor dance! And you're just like, oh, okay, that's
yeah,
nice.
You gotta, and you have to pretend like, oh, okay.
Yeah, you have to pretend like this is wonderful to see.
Oh, this is like, great.
It's a joyous occasion.
This is the leader of everything? Okay, cool. Oh,
there's wonderful. A scene in this same show where Caligula is yet again kind of slandered in history a little bit, where he gets his sister pregnant, and then starts to fear while she's pregnant that the baby will usurp his power. So he cuts the baby out of her, killing her, and then eats the fetus.
Whoa.
But it doesn't really show it. They had to cut it so many times to get it released.
It's just implied.
But it's implied that Caligula did that. Of course, there's no historical basis for any of that happening.
Yeah, you know.
But it's okay, right?
I know there's a historical basis of Caligula
the legend
dancing around.
Fact, print the legend.
You know, like this, barely clothed.
I am eager to get into the Sodom and Gomorrah stuff, but there is a few more things on Caligula.
Let's put a fucking bow on Caligula, dude.
The story of his horse.
Yeah.
There's a popular story that Caligula made his horse a senator.
I thought it was that he threatened to make his horse a senator.
Yeah, or yep. Something along those lines. Here's some material on that. Historians have some fragmented records of Caligula by his contemporaries, such as the orator Seneca, Pliny the Elder, and Philo of Alexandria. But unfortunately, most of the Caligula legend has come to us from one historian, Gaius Suetonius Tranquillus, who lived a century after Caligula.
Right.
He was not exactly an unbiased writer. He worked for the imperial family of the times, the Flavians. It was in his best interest to make the original imperial family, the Julians, look as wicked as possible.
Oh, and by the way, just a total aside, the Colosseum is called the Flavian Amphitheater, so give you just a clue about that.
So basically, this is a guy who's writing for the new family who hates the old family and wants to make them look as awful as possible.
Of course.
Suetonius was a sensational writer, but an erratic historian. It was from him that the world learned about Incitatus? 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 I don't know.
Is that his horse?
I guess so. I'm probably not pronouncing that anywhere in the ballpark of correct. Caligula's favorite racehorse. Whether Caligula actually made the stallion a senator and then a consul, president of the Senate, is unknown. But this story has stuck down through the centuries. Historian Alois Winterling points out that Caligula may have only threatened to make the horse a consul in order to insult the Senate.
He just wanted to piss off the Senate.
Showing them that they were powerless compared to the emperor.
He just threatened it. Oh, okay.
He might have just threatened it. He might not. I mean, it might just be total bullshit. Who knows?
Yep.
Records are spotty.
None of his contemporary, like, historians that lived during his time mention anything about him making a horse a fucking...
A lot of the things that we just learned about Caligula come from that account, so there's...
I think that that's the kind of the point. We don't have to go through everything on that list you've got in front of you. I think Caligula kind of gets a bum rap in modern times. Like, in the movie, he's portrayed as this just, like, totally... insane blood. Like, we talked earlier about how he liked to cuck dudes.
The incest thing might be made up.
Yeah. But, like, nowadays it's okay, right? Because it's Caligula. We've all decided that he's evil. But I think when you look at it, he was pretty par for the course and, you know, like, comparable at least to other fucking Caesars and other emperors of the time. Like, he was bloodthirsty. You know, ruthless.
Is this stuff in bold something you wrote, or is this from something you pulled?
That's what history decides, too.
I pulled that from.
Well, here's the conclusion of I don't know where you pulled this from, but some kind of historian. On the whole, Caligula seems to have been a somewhat worse ruler than the average amongst the rogues gallery of first century emperors, but not dramatically so. Allowance have been made for exaggeration and invention. Tiberius and several of the brief reigning emperors come across as only slightly better than Caligula. Nero and Domitian were at least as bad as Caligula and possibly worse. When the porn flicks about them are released, I think I'll sit them out.
I won't. I'll go.
Yeah, me too.
I'll go see a Nero film and then I'll go see a Domitian film too.
The thing about it is I think that a lot of this stuff is like people kind of, he's such a tailor-made monster that I think that it's fun to exaggerate what he was because people have these dark impulses and stuff inside themselves and they like to give it a personification, give it some sort of voice, give it some sort of outlet. And, you know, so it's kind of fun to, you know, make Caligula worse and worse with every generation. Like, you know, because you have, what's that historian's name again?
Suetonius.
Suetonius, who exaggerated Caligula 100 years later. And we've exaggerated him even more with the films that have been made.
Well, that cucking,
Claudius TV show.
That thing that you talked about where he liked to cuck people. In the movie, he not only does that, and he makes the dude watch while he does it. And then when he's done... he fists that guy. So he's like, now I'm done fucking your wife. Now I'm going to fist you.
Well, also, it's...
So we take a lot of liberties with Caligula.
But it's also the sources of the information that... The main source of information is someone that really did not live in the same time period.
It wasn't in their best interests be in favor of him.
Yeah, so I mean, when we look at it, that and the fucking profound impact the Roman Empire had on, you know, Western European history for
so long.
I'd
love to do that job, dude. I'd love to be that job for, like... you know, George H.W. Bush or something 100 years from now. Be like, all right, so he raped an elephant once. You know what I mean? He was fucking crazy. Raped an elephant.
Well, I mean, look at it this way. Like, look how he lionized the founders of this country. I mean, it's the same shit is just happening to Caligula. The same thing's happened to all the emperors. Julius Caesar is seen as, like, this great military leader. And then pretty much some of the Caesars have these great reputations. Some dictators are just beloved, even though when you look at it, that's what they were. They were dictators. And then some leaders are looked at like shit. And Caligula, I mean... ultimately, he's just a person. He was a person. He lived. He probably did some fucked up shit, but he had absolute power.
There's Scotty's fucking insight for you. Caligula was a human.
Well, no, I'm saying that...
Fucking brilliant, Scotty!
What I'm trying to say, TJ, is that...
What you're trying to say is you're a dumb faggot!
Almost anyone in a position of power is going to make questionable judgments, and of course history is going to judge some people favorably and some not. I mean, he was killed political opponents, so of course he's going to be judged poorly.
You remember George H.W. Bush, dude?
His reign was a failure.
Yeah, dude. He had a fucking pack of starving walruses that he kept. He kept them so hungry that he would throw children to them, and they would all fight over the children. And then when they were done with the children, he would throw their mothers in there and let the same walruses eat the mothers of the children.
Not only that, but you know, he also had trained wolves that he trained to just prowl the streets and eat the homeless.
Yeah, and he made a chimp his chief of staff, chimpanzee, dude. I shit you not.
I really hope 2,000 years from now they are doing fucking shit like that, where they're talking about like early American history.
Trump.
Yeah, then Trump, who was mad with power, raped his daughter in the Oval Office.
The sad thing is Trump will probably just get hotter with age, because you look at all the, you know, like, reproductions of fucking Caligula. He's all fucking good looking and shit. So Trump will probably be this big mountain of a man.
Yeah.
Big, roguishly handsome, fucking 5 o'clock shadow, six pack.
It's time to make America great again.
All right, it's time for a subject change. I think we've explored the subject of Caligula about as well as three degenerate stoner morons possibly can.
Caligula lives matter, dude.
So it's time to move on to the tale of Sodom and Gomorrah. This is the first part of our series on Bible stories.
It's like some Bible study with the drunk... Not the drunken peasants. I'm an idiot.
You fucking retard.
God, I'm so stupid. With Deep Fat Fried.
Drunken fucking what?
We'll probably just have to cut that out.
Nah, we ain't cutting shit out. Your mistake lives on. All right, so Sodom and motherfucking Gomorrah. And the Lord said... This is from Genesis 18:20-33, by the way. And the Lord said, because the cry of Sodom and Gomorrah is great, and because their sin is very grievous, I will go down now. He's going to go down on Sodom and Gomorrah.
Sweet.
And see whether they have done altogether according to the cry of it, which has come unto me. And if not, I will know.
So why would God need to go down there to see that shit? Isn't he everywhere and everything? And can't he see all this shit?
God is hands-on in the Old Testament. He really wants to go down there and see what's going
on. He is like an old man that lives in a cloud and shit. And he's got to go like, well, I'm just going to float
down
there.
I'm
going to
send down some angels to see what's what. And the men turned their faces from thence and went towards Sodom. But Abraham stood yet before the Lord. And actually here, I found, guys, you know there's these fucking crazy cartoons on YouTube and shit?
Yeah.
I found some biblical cartoons.
Cool.
In that same terrible animation style. They're just completely wretched. And I'm going to show you.
I already know what it is.
So this is Abraham. Do you know what it is? Because this is pretty obscure shit.
No, man, like I know the style is what I'm saying.
So here is Abraham bargaining with God for the preservation of Sodom and Gomorrah.
Okay.
Because before God tells Abraham, like, I'm going to go destroy Sodom and Gomorrah, and Abraham starts trying, the original Jew, tries to Jew God down.
Well, he negotiates, dude. He does what
he's a fucking negotiator.
Any responsible person does that with God. They negotiate.
So, I'm just going to warn you, what I'm about to show you is cringy and painful. But I'm going to show it to you.
Let's see it. Oh, this is awful.
I've heard that the people in Sodom and Gomorrah are very evil. The sufferings in
they
both
are very evil.
I heard it.
The people in Sodom and Gomorrah are very evil.
This is Buddhist from IRS.
Listen, I have heard that the people in the Sodom and the Gomorrah, they're very evil.
Have you tried restarting your computer?
Yes. Have you tried, sir? You need to install program and give to me the last 4 digits social security, please.
This is some like total go animate shit too.
This is.
I'm going to see for myself if what I've heard is correct.
Oh, I guess maybe he's an African
dude. If it
is
correct,
I don't know where it's from.
I don't
know.
Then
I will destroy the city.
Okay.
You would destroy good people along with wicked people. What if there are 50 good people in the city? Would you destroy them with the rest?
Nah. If I find 50 good people in Sodom, I'll spare that city.
Wow.
Okay.
It's like an episode of that fucking, what's that, Pawn Stars shit we watch every once in a while.
Yeah.
It's like God is Rick, you know, and
can you do 50?
Abraham is the fucking, you know, the person bringing their old LP in to see what it's worth.
Watch Abraham Jew God.
He's
down,
the OG
though.
Jew, dude.
Check it out.
But if you find only 40.
40?
For the sake of 40, I'll spare the city.
All right, 40.
We're down to 40.
He's on his knees now. He'll suck God's dick.
Lord, please don't be angry with me. But what if there is only 30, or 20, or even 10?
10?
See, now, this is where they kind of, truncated it here, made it a little shorter, because, like, it literally, in the Bible, it literally goes back and forth. He's not, like, you know, he goes from 50 to 45, and then it starts going, it says, then it goes to 30, and then it goes to 20, and, like, literally, it's just a back and forth, like, behold, now I have taken upon me to speak unto the Lord. But perhaps there shall be 20 found there.
The strange thing is doesn't God already know there's not that many righteous men in Sodom?
Yeah, God doesn't... Look, God in this story does not know what the fuck is going on.
Is just this insanely powerful being that you have to please.
Yeah, but he's not... In this story, he's not depicted as being omnipotent or omniscient or any of that shit.
No.
He doesn't know how many righteous people there are. And by the way, this fucking little bargaining exchange here never really comes into play anyway. Like, there's never a scene where God, you know, where the angels are like looking around
and
the city.
And lo, he went to the city
trying to find all the righteous people.
Yeah, and found not enough righteous men. You know, like, it doesn't happen.
I mean, look, people are butt fucking in Sodom and Gomorrah. I'm taking all the risk here. Look, 10, I'll give you, 10 is as high as I'll go. But, sir, what about 15? No, 10. 10 is, I'm telling you, 10 is my rock bottom.
10, final offer.
I'm not even real comfortable with that.
Look, if you'll do 10, we got a deal.
Good people in Sodom, will you destroy the city even then?
What? No.
If I can find 10 good and righteous people in Sodom, then I'll spare the entire city for them. Thank you, Lord. You are so kind. Thank you.
Well, if he went down to 1, then he would have been okay.
Yeah.
How the fuck is that kind? Like, I'm going to go destroy a city. Well, what if there's 10 good people there? Will you destroy it then? I guess not. You're so kind.
Why did he stop at 10? Why didn't he go?
Yeah, he's like, how about 9? Like, can we just, how about 9? Yeah. Eventually, God just going to be like, all right, you're smote, bitch.
What? Like after 1, he could have been like, what if there's one dude that's like half righteous and half wicked, but half of the time he's totally righteous? Then would you spare the city?
What if there's someone who's a total prick? What if everyone there is a total prick, but one guy occasionally has a righteous thought? Would you spare the city then? Would you spare the fucking city then, God?
I think
God,
he could have got
the guy that
pretty-
one time, he helped some woman carry her groceries home. How about that? But he did sodomize her afterwards, but he did help her carry the groceries.
God's a terrible negotiator, too. He doesn't even really offer any resistance all the way down from 50. He's like, yeah, I'll take 40.
I guess God was highballing, dude. He was like 50. He's like, I mean, this guy's a Jew. He's going to try to Jew me down. So God knew. He wanted to arrive at 10. He started at 50. So God's
got
a good... I mean, he's God. He's a good negotiator.
Right.
Come on.
You gotta think.
All right, so after that totally pointless scene of that meaningless negotiation...
That never goes anywhere, so plot thread
that
you
has
can forget
no,
about.
Yeah, it has nothing to
just
do with
forget
it.
About
it
that.
Happens.
That doesn't come up again.
And there came two angels to Sodom at evening. This is, we're on Genesis 19 now, by the way.
Got it.
There came two angels to Sodom in the evening, and Lot sat in the gate of Sodom. And Lot, seeing them, rose up to meet them, and he bowed himself and his face towards the ground. And he said, behold now, my lords, turn in, I pray you, into your servant's house, and tarry all night, and wash your feet, and ye shall rise up early and go on your ways.
So he's saying, like, come on in, guys. Yeah. Come on in. Use my house,
mi
man.
Mi casa, su casa.
Yeah,
come on,
you know,
guys.
Hey, strangers, come on in. You know, I got room.
Strange that Lot
I'll wash your feet, you know.
It's strange that Lot was just sitting by the city gate, though.
Was the gatekeeper of the city.
Oh, he was? Okay, so that was actually his job.
Yes. And they said,
well, that's convenient.
They refused at first. They said, nay, but we will remain in the streets all night. and he pressed upon them greatly, and they turned in unto him and entered into his house. So basically, he said, no, that's not a good idea.
He's like, yeah, dude,
you don't want to be on the streets in Sodom.
Sodom and Gomorrah is like the hood, dude. You know, yeah. you ain't going to feel safe.
You don't want to do that.
But yeah, I don't know where you're from, but like, you don't want to be two angels walking around late at night in Sodom.
And he made them a feast of baked and baked unleavened bread. Sounds gross.
A feast of bread.
Yeah, I don't think, to me, of some bread is not a feast. And they ate, so that's good.
Well, they were hungry. They needed to eat. Why do angels need to eat, though? I mean, do angels really, do they shit? Oh, yeah.
Where do the angels shit?
I mean, God is made, God, we're made in God's image and we shit. I assume the angels are the same.
Oh, okay. Is gold angel shit that's fallen down from heaven?
Why not?
Cool.
But before they lay down, the men of the city, even the men of Sodom, both young and old, all the people from every quarter.
Wow.
So basically the entire town is like, we're going to descend on Lot's house.
Yo, you guys want to get some angel ass right now? Like,
compass the house around. And they called unto Lot and said unto him, where are the men who came in to thee this night? Bring them out unto us that we may know them.
Oh.
So like the scent of angel booty is so intoxicating to the people of Sodom that every fucking man, young, old, crippled, fucking, it doesn't matter.
It's like, we are ready
they
to...
They want to know them.
We like, want to fucking pound those
carnal
fucking angel butts
fucking
now.
Knowledge.
We heard that there is some fresh fucking angel booty, and Lot's old ass is trying to fucking hoard all that angel ass for himself, and we ain't having it.
Yeah, they're pissed at Lot. I mean, they're assuming Lot's in there fucking... He's going one after the other. I mean, he's got two fine-ass angels in there, and this fucking mob's like, you know what, Lot? You need to fucking share with us.
So Lot heads on outside. He's like, I pray you, brethren, do not so wickedly... Behold now, I have two daughters who have not known a man. Let me, I pray you, bring them out to you, and do ye to them as is good in your eyes.
Whoa.
Wow.
So only unto these men do nothing, for they therefore came they under the shadow of my roof.
So this is like, yeah, the sanctity of my doorway is more important to me than my daughter's pussy. So here you go. Go rape my daughters. Do whatever you want
them. Let's be honest. I mean, women are just worth less than men.
Yeah, I mean, is Lot's daughter's pussy a real good place, like a good replacement for angel booty? Like the golden fucking amazing angel booty?
Well, you know, Lot was not the OG Jew. He didn't have the same negotiating power
or
scales.
Yeah, if Abraham had been there,
right.
Abraham could have Jewed them down to two fucking virgin girls.
Yeah, the mob would have dispersed. They'd have been like, okay, so we get two virgin girls? We'll take that
tonight.
Dude,
if Abraham was there, he would have Jewed them down to them going home and jerking off. Like, that would have been it,
yeah,
dude.
I mean, he negotiated with God.
Listen,
so.
Ye need not know these angel booties. Remember, thou hast lotion in thine cabinet at home and a fist good for pumping. Go thy thence. You know, and they'd be like, all right, sounds good, Abraham. I haven't jerked off in a while. I've been too busy raping angels. Take a little angel rape break and fist my dick for a while. Good idea, Abraham.
And so the mob is not having it. The mob is like, fuck you, stand back. And
we
they said
them.
Again, this one fellow came in to sojourn, and he will become a judge. Now will we deal worse with thee than with them. And they pressed sore upon the man, even
Damn.
Lot,
Ooh.
And came near to break the door.
So
the mob
like,
is not having it. They're going to break in and rape these fucking
angels.
If they're going to rape the angels, what are they going to do to Lot? Because they said they're going to do even worse to him. So they're going to like rape him with like a hot iron or something?
I don't know, dude.
They're going to punish Lot. Well,
they're
going to
shove his daughters up his ass.
They fucking...
The to mob, fucking spurn his offer.
Well, the mob is fucking mad, dude. I mean, look, they think Lot's in there getting all the fucking booty he wants. Like, he's got a booty buck fucking buffet, dude. He's going, he's fucking those angels left and right. The mob's out there all fucking horny, got some hard-ons.
Yeah, like, at some point...
Their fucking dicks are hard. They're like, I want to go fuck some angel ass. And
You're sitting there at a fucking tavern, and someone comes in. It's like, hey, man, did you hear those two hot-ass angels that came into town today? What? Yeah, Lot's over there fucking hoarding that booty all to himself. while the rest of us sit here with these useless fucking erections we can't do nothing fucking with.
Fuck this. Ring the town bells.
You know
every
what?
Man.
Let's get a mob together. Every
quarter of the city.
Person in town.
Come on.
Even the men. Even the men. And the men said on the lot, hast thou any besides son-in-law? I don't know what that's supposed to mean. And thy sons and thy daughters and whomsoever thou hast in the city, bring them out of this place. Oh, I'm sorry. I missed a part. That's the angels talking. That's after the angels cast a big blinding fucking light to fucking defeat the mob.
Yeah, the angels used blinding. It was super effective.
Yeah, used blind on the rape crazy mob. And it worked.
For we will destroy this place because the cry of them has waxed great before the face of the Lord. And
no
the Lord
shit.
Hath sent us to destroy it.
I kind of agree with the Lord on this one. I don't find myself doing that often. But
so, you know, an entire... I guess if...
You
like,
can't walk into town without being butt-raped by every man in the city. Yeah, I think it's time to get rid of that city.
I don't often agree with God, but he's got a fucking point. Yeah, let's fucking destroy this fucking town.
So Lot goes to talk to his sons-in-law, who apparently were not part of this mob, even though it said everyone in town was there, I guess.
Maybe they're out in the mob. He was like, Frank, is that you out there? Come here. Let's talk about this.
And Lot went out and spoke unto his sons-in-law, who married his daughters. Wait, I thought his daughters had never known a man. That doesn't make sense. Whatever. And said, up, get ye out of this place, for the Lord will destroy the city. But he seemed as one who mocked unto his sons-in-law. So they're like, we don't believe you.
Yeah, bullshit.
Yeah, boo.
And when the morning Fake arose, news. Then the angels hastened Lot, saying, arise, take thy wife and thy two daughters who are here, lest thou be consumed in the iniquity of the city.
Whoa.
That was nice of them to give them a heads up for protecting their booties from every cock in Sodom.
Basically, Sodom is going bye-bye. The Lord has had enough of this bullshit.
Who can blame him? They wanted to rape us. We're done. We reported back to God, and he's like, we're just giving you a heads up, bud. You might want to be out by like 3 p.m.
And while he lingered, the men laid hold upon his hand and upon the hand of his wife and upon the hand of his two daughters, the Lord being merciful unto them, and they brought him forth and set him outside the city. And it came to pass, when they had brought them forth outside, that he said, escape for thy life, look not behind thee, neither stay thou in all the plain, escape to the mountain, lest thee be consumed. And Lot said to them, oh, not so, my lord. Behold now, thy servant hath found grace in thy sight, and thou hast magnified thy mercy, which thou hast shown unto me in saving my life. And I cannot escape to the mountain, lest some evil take me and I die. So basically he's saying he's too old, he's not physically fit enough to make it to the fucking mountain is what he's saying there.
Right.
Just don't stop believing. Come on, dude. You can do it, Lot. We believe in you.
Behold now, this city is near enough to flee unto, and it is a little one. Oh, let me escape thither.
Thither and hither.
And my soul shall live. Okay.
So Lot runs out of the city.
So
he bounces. He's like, fucking, I got to get out of this place.
So Lot runs off. His wife, being the stupid bitch that she is,
doesn't listen to the fucking angels whose booties were protected the night before.
Yeah, it's like, you got a fucking angel of the Lord who apparently is real and is destroying your city that told you specifically, don't look back. Yeah.
Don't
and
check it out.
And this dumb bitch.
I probably would have been a pillar of salt out there, too, though.
Oh, you're
honestly.
Already a pillar
I mean, you
of salt.
I know,
yeah.
But I mean, like, I would have literally been a pillar of salt.
I mean, yet again, look, this is another example. You fucking told the woman to do something. A fucking angel told her, it's like, look, bitch, I'm going to level with you right now. If you look back, you're going to become a fucking pile of salt. And she's all like, that angel's full of shit.
So
I'd want to see the explosion, too.
Cool guys don't look at explosions, Paul.
Yeah.
I'm not a cool guy. When did I claim to be a cool guy?
No, I'm just saying, though, Paul. Like, look, Paul, if a fucking angel told you, I mean...
Dorks look at explosions, yeah. Man. I want to look at that.
But
I want to see
angel,
Sodom.
If an angel told you, Paul, you would become a pillar of fucking salt if you looked at an explosion, would you still look?
I mean,
like, why didn't they just say that?
You believe in all
like,
this shit.
Why did they just say, don't look back? Why don't they say, like, if you look back, you will turn into a pillar of salt and die?
Plus, like, how long does that fucking stay? You know, can I look back once I get to the mountain and look at the smoldering crater?
And why can't you look back? I mean, what's the problem with looking back and seeing the city be destroyed? Shouldn't they be, like, cheering the city being destroyed? Shouldn't God be happy that they're witnessing the destruction?
So, This is the one righteous man in all of Sodom. It's the most cliche observation you could possibly make, but it's kind of interesting that the one righteous man that they that God decides to spare in this whole city is a guy who, if he has a choice between letting two total strangers he's never met before get raped or offering his daughters up to get raped, he's immediately like, no fucking contest. Rape my daughters, please.
Yeah,
but it's obvious why.
Biblical morality for you.
You see it so many times in the Bible. It's like you always choose God over your family. There's not even a contest because you have to put this first in your life. Even in your that's basically what the allegory of the story is. Like no matter what, this is more important. Even Lot, look right here. Lot offered his two daughters, his own life, anything to stop this mob from harming these angels.
Now, yep. Once Lot and his two daughters got to the mountain, some interesting stuff happened. I'm finally gonna get a fucking break from reading this dry, boring ass book. Because I'm just going to show you a little two-minute animation from Dark Matter 2525, who generously has allowed his clip to be played here on this show.
Cool.
So this is what happens next when Lot and his daughters escape. This is biblically accurate. Check it out.
It's like sucks.
Yeah. How shall we bear
their tits
children?
Really were that big,
because
too.
Because that's all women are good for, right? And there's no one here to fuck.
Shh! Daddy might hear.
Wait, I know. Let's fuck Daddy.
Oh, come on. He would never. Unless the writer of this story can invent a convoluted, unrealistic contrivance that would allow Daddy to retain his righteousness.
I know. We shall get him so drunk that he passes out, and then he won't know he's fucking us.
Yeah, but he's so old, and we're virgins. Won't it be difficult for him to...
Well, that's actually the least of thy problems. Because drinking that much alcohol dilates the blood vessels in the penis, making it impossible to sustain an erection anyway. Especially if he doesn't even know that he's having sex. And the older the man, the less alcohol it takes to cause this effect. So this plan is actually really, really stupid.
Oh. So I guess it won't work then.
No, it'll work. The writer of this story doesn't know anything about vasodilation.
Oh, cool. So you do him the first night, then tomorrow night we'll get him drunk again, and then it'll be my turn.
He totally won't suspect a thing.
At least until we're both totally rockin' matching baby bumps.
Well, he probably wouldn't knock both of us up on the first try, unless we're simultaneously ovulating.
Oh, so I guess it won't work after all.
No, actually, we'll get knocked up immediately.
No, the writer of the story doesn't seem that bright.
Yep, we shall be one big happy family.
Abe, I'd like to introduce you to the family you convinced me to save.
Oh, very good.
This is Moab and Ben.
Hello there, kids.
This is their father, Lot, the only righteous man in Sodom and Gomorrah.
Pleased to meet thee, Lot.
Oh, and this is their grandfather, Lot, the only righteous man in Sodom and Gomorrah.
Oh, pleased to meet ye...
Daddy tried to have us gang raped.
Haha, yeah, I did.
Sweet.
Totally true.
So, yeah, so the whole parable of Sodom and Gomorrah is to uphold Lot as this guy that's an example of what you should be. Offers his daughters up to be raped and then fucks
and
them
then
himself.
Gets raped by his daughters in a weird little. Like, okay, whoever wrote this fucking story had some fucking issues, man. Because he's sitting there like, God damn it, I just wish that I could have sex with my daughters. Okay, what if the town was destroyed and then we had to escape to the mountains and their mother was dead, she's turned to a pillar of salt, but I mean, it still wouldn't be right to rape them. I know.
He was gonna.
What if they
them.
Get me drunk and they rape me because they think that's the only way to propagate the human fucking race?
Boom.
Then I can fucking guiltlessly fuck and impregnate my own daughters. It's brilliant. I mean, this guy was just writing like the erotic fan fiction of the fucking day.
Sounds like it.
But you have to remember, look, God works in mysterious ways, TJ. Even though God could at any point intercede and said, yo, Lot, no, dude. You don't have to fuck your daughters. There's more women in the world.
There are so many things God could have done in
this
story.
Well, that's what I'm saying.
God could have gone to Sodom and Gomorrah and been like, He could have just been like, you are wicked, I am God, behold, I am real, you must
stop
live your lives
wicked.
By this, stop doing the things
or
this way.
Or he could have just removed all the wicked people and sent all the good people.
If God's all powerful, he could have snapped his fingers and made them all just vanish without doing any damage to the city. He could have
just
looked into
them.
The hearts of all the people who are bad and destroyed them and preserved the innocent. Like, because, you know, there was like... children in the city, like, were all the children wicked rapists too?
Oh, all Sodomites,
oh, yeah.
Dude.
Oh yeah, dude.
There wasn't any good people in the whole fucking city.
Lot.
Dude, like in
except
Sodom,
Lot, the fucking daughter offer up raper and daughter get raped buyer. I mean, what
dude,
the
in
fuck?
Sodom, fetuses come straight out of the womb and then go straight back in and rape the same fucking vagina they fell out of.
They rape Jesus. Their mother's pussy
yes.
as they come out of it.
Yes.
Damn.
That's how fucking wicked Sodom and Gomorrah
that's
were.
That's how hardcore they are. But that's the story. So let's take a look at how that story has been perceived by various people throughout history. Or in our modern context, rather. Oh, I did want to play another very brief clip from that creepy animation I showed you guys earlier.
All right, let's take a look.
Because this is... This is the best. This is the end. This is okay. I'm not even gonna.
Is Indian guy back?
Includes the story of the twin cities.
Yes.
Sodom and Gomorrah. Did you all enjoy the story?
Yes, Father.
Very good. Do you have any questions from the story? No questions? Shall I ask you a few questions then?
Yes, Father.
I've got a few fucking questions.
These little fucking robots. Yes, Father, we have... Dude, that's what they look like. They look like little fucking robots. Blank fucking face, unquestioning, unflinching fucking robots.
I love that. It almost,
yes, Father.
Anyone have any questions about that story? If I was a kid, I'd have a ton of fucking questions about that story.
Dude, like, there's no way you would
just
tell
be
a
like,
kid...
So Lot was the good guy? Yeah.
Dude, I
didn't really seem that good.
Can you talk more about how he banged his daughters?
Yeah, some kid in the back.
I wish you could
part.
Read a classroom full of kids this story and then really have them go, because if you have any questions, they would be asking a million fucking questions.
What position did he bang his daughters in, Father?
How big was Lot's dick?
Was he packing a fucking big kielbasa, or did he have like a second belly button down there?
We've actually seen this painting. I believe this painting is in the Louvre. Or something similar to
there's
that.
There's quite a few of them.
I
had quite a few to choose from. This was just one of many.
Look at that lecherous old fuck over there, dude.
He knows what he's doing.
Oh, he knows exactly.
Where the fuck
he's like, oh, man, I'm so fucking drunk.
Oh,
man.
I'm way too drunk. He's throwing that wine behind
him,
dude.
Where's this fucking wine even coming from, dude?
Yeah, where the fuck do they get wine in the damn mountain anyway?
Yeah, that's
good
true.
Good point.
They have a fucking goblet. Lot's all like fucked up, dude.
Maybe they've been planning on
doing
that
for a while. Maybe they packed it when
maybe they carried it up.
I mean, so the daughters kind of just knew. They had they were divinely guided. Like, look, you gotta take your fucking daddy's dick.
And that's
I mean,
and God at no point is like, hey guys, you're actually not the only people left on Earth. You don't have to.
Thou shouldst not do that because thou wilt have retarded children. But no, God is once again absent. No, once again, doesn't give anybody any advice. Great.
No, that. But it'd be one thing, but like these are people that are actually supposed to be like, or they really obey God. They're really looking out for whatever the Lord says. Like we gotta obey the Lord. And he doesn't even have the courtesy to say, "Don't fuck your daughter just because it's not necessary." There's other people in the world.
Yeah, man, it's gonna be okay. So you don't need to fuck your daughters. There are other people. Sodom's not the only place. It's cool.
Sodom and Gomorrah are but two cities. Out of an entire planet.
But I mean,
with
if you look
cities.
At one biblical interpretation of this, would be that incest is permissible if you think that your bloodline has to continue.
Yeah.
I mean, really, when you look at it, I mean, if you interpret it later on, you could say that. Say, look, Lot did it with his daughters. I mean, that had to happen. There is a biblical precedent for this to occur.
Why would God, like, I guess it doesn't make any sense, dude. Why would God, like, allow it to happen? Why wouldn't he just go down there and tell him?
Once again, though, in this story, obviously not an omnipresent or omniscient God.
Well, if he is, he's kinky as fuck.
Yeah, maybe God was just
sitting up there. This whole thing was just a fucking elaborate scheme for God to set up this fucking incest.
Dude, maybe it was like this, dude. TJ, and you probably had this happen, like you're browsing porn sites, you're like, man, I gotta find the right video. Maybe God had to find the right situation to get off. He's all like, okay, I'm gonna destroy this city. This dude's gonna bang his daughters. It's gonna be fucking great. They're gonna get them fucking drunk.
Yeah. We're gonna start off with this rape scenario. I'm gonna send two of my hottest angels down there to Sodom, where you know they love angel booty.
They love that shit.
They're gonna go down there, but you know what? They're all gonna be denied. They're gonna be standing there with their boners sticking out. And then Lot's gonna offer up his fucking daughters, and they're gonna rape them. Do they actually rape the daughters?
No.
Lot is a pretty good negotiator. He was like, look, I know this is a bunch of fags out there. Let's send two girls out there. How does he make that bargain? They came there for man ass. Like, how is a pussy a replacement?
Yeah.
I don't get it.
No fun.
So
all right.
He's a good bargainer though.
So we got some people here. I thought I'd give you a little bit of the conservative perspective on this and then give you a little bit of the liberal perspective on this story.
What's the liberal perspective?
The liberal Christian perspective.
Got it.
The apologist perspective. So here's I got a few guys that are basically these are the people who think that that this is actually a good moral story and all that shit. So here we go. This guy, I just happened upon this motherfucker. He's just a crazy son of a bitch.
Then you got the black woman down here with blonde. Come on, man. The platinum blonde, like they call it.
Yeah.
All of them is dressed provocative.
I mean, not that much.
Is that Lot?
Yeah, that's, there he is.
You know, my daughter's over there, man. They always running around in these skimpy ass bikinis and bullshit.
They're not really dressed super provocative. I mean, some of them are, but
one of these nights I'm gonna drink a bunch of wine and I'm gonna fuck
but
my
also,
daughters.
What the fuck does this have to do with Sodom and Gomorrah?
Well, he'll mention it,
you know. And it's not that it's just because in Sodom and Gomorrah you had this, but it wasn't broadcast. This is going on 24/7, man. This don't sleep.
So the Real Housewives of Atlanta was a show in Sodom and Gomorrah? Was it syndicated to Gomorrah,
24
too?
Hours a day, too. This shit didn't fucking stop. People in Sodom and Gomorrah were just addicted to Real Housewives of Atlanta, even though Atlanta technically didn't exist then. I mean,
it sounds from the fucking story that Sodom and Gomorrah was more about just raping angel ass. Like, they didn't really have time for the Real Housewives, whatever.
That's where the definition of sodomy came from, was basically someone, it had a biblical origin in that people that were sodomites were basically people who were fucking the ass were from Sodom.
It in the butt.
Yeah, I mean.
We like
this
butt
place
sex.
Is pushing it out all, it don't, is continual, man.
All these women wanted to fuck angels in the ass?
Them hoes on there jumping around and bouncing on rods, man. Come on, man.
Bouncing on rods?
So,
bouncing on rods, man.
I like to ask this dude. Would this dude object to any of them bouncing on his fucking rod? I don't think
yes,
so.
Yes, they do.
Wait a minute. Hold on.
Watch this. Hold on.
All right.
And this is what is the standard of the American woman, man.
Really?
Okay. Who the hell want that? Who want to wake up to that, man?
Who wants to wake up?
I mean, those are some pretty big, fat, black asses over there.
Yeah,
who wants to wake up next to an attractive woman?
Yeah, nobody.
Not this fucking dude.
I think this guy is a little bit more of a Sodom fan than
maybe,
he wants
maybe
to.
Maybe he was upset that he couldn't be in Sodom and Gomorrah before all that fucking shit went down. Maybe he wanted to fuck some angel
ass.
He's
like the angry mob turning down the daughters. He's like, what, some fine-ass bitches? Fuck that.
Nah,
give
angel
some,
booty
give me some
is
angel
where
booty, nigga.
Now, if they really are bouncing on Rod on the Real Housewives of Atlanta, I'm probably going to check it out.
Yeah,
like, I've never seen an episode of it, but there's a little Rod about it.
Basically softcore porn.
Sweet.
Mind, let me say, because there's some weak simps out there that would love to have any one of them.
Why are they weak simps, and why are you stronger than them for not wanting to fuck these women?
Yeah, like, I see attractive women, I'm like, fuck that. I don't want to tap that. I want that
That's
fucking
gross.
Angel ass.
That's
Ew.
Gross.
When a bitch comes in and she's all smelling good, and her titties is all out, and her ass look fine, man, gross. Ugh. Man, send that bitch out. Get that super fucking hot bitch
up
out of here.
Watch what he does at the end here.
Ezekiel. Man, matter of fact, I can't even look at that shit.
He can't even look at it, dude. It's so depraved and
I can't even look at that shit.
Can't even look at that shit. That's gross.
Ugh! Nasty old hot bitches with their nice fucking titties and big round asses. Ew! Gross!
Yeah, I think he fucking protests too much, dude. That dude would fucking nail any of those chicks.
Oh, dude, if one of those fucking housewives of Atlanta fucking showed up on his door and was like, "What's up, creepy black beardy dude? I want to bounce on your rod." He'd be like, "No!" No, of course. He didn't. He'd have him right
his
in.
His staff and his rod.
All right,
dude.
Paul, I've been wanting to show this. I didn't show this to you because I wanted to just see your fucking genuine reaction to what I'm about to show you here. This is great.
I find fascinating parallels in the history of Sodom and Gomorrah and that of our current culture, especially in the United States. The document, which has become commonly known in America as Declaration of Independence, recognizes that the Creator has endowed every human being with absolute rights that no civil or religious entity has the right to alienate from the individual. The public school system in the United States...
No. What? Okay.
Oh, no.
You know what?
What's he doing? Why is he dressed like that? Why is he dressed up in a fucking yarmulke and a robe and standing on the steps? What is that for?
I don't even know, dude. And he's in Washington, D.C. It's like, I don't even fucking understand.
He's dressed up like Lot to talk about human rights? Bad fucking choice, dude.
Hold up. This is getting
better. States was originally established to teach children how to read the Bible so that they could...
He's saying that the education system of the United States was originally established to teach kids how to read the Bible.
Yeah, that's the only thing worth reading is the Bible.
...could never be stripped of their God-given rights. For the past several generations, however, the Department of Re-Education in Washington, D.C.
has forced
the once independent schools to teach that life is just the result of millions of years of aberrant chance mutations in a purely mechanical...
I wish a kid would skateboard by behind him and go, "Boo, you fucking suck!" Throw something at him.
Or steal his stick.
Yeah, snatch his walking stick.
Just another version of creationist nonsense. You know, we took God out of schools.
I just love his
costume. It's all just random chance. If a tornado goes through a junkyard, you're going to make an airplane?
Universe, and there is no creator. The nice sterile term for this is evolution. But if there is no creator, then there are no creator given rights.
It's not a sterile term, it's a factual term.
Right, and evolution doesn't even say that there is no creator.
Yeah, and evolution
has nothing to do with it.
The supposition there is totally false. It doesn't follow at all.
Republic was founded. Without God given rights, we are left with only government given rights. And what the government giveth, the government taketh away.
Okay, well, you know what? When God comes down and tells you you have those rights, that's when you have God-given rights, buddy.
So is he, like, at the beginning he said he sees a lot of parallels between Sodom and Gomorrah. Are there a lot of, like, angel rapes going on in the Capitol or something that we need to know about?
Oh, yeah, dude.
Oh, it's just, I think he's going for the, it's wicked. We live in a wicked land, so we're removing God from everything, just like they did in Sodom and Gomorrah.
Well, here, if you want an even more explicit exploration of how America's like Sodom and Gomorrah, I do have a clip.
Well, let's see.
A guy talking about Billy Graham.
So,
newsflash. The world's most famous evangelist, Billy Graham, said, "America is just as wicked as Sodom and Gomorrah." But the dateline on that quote-unquote newsflash is 1962. Ironically, the year before Bible reading was taken out of the public schools, and 11 full years before the United States Supreme Court's infamous Roe v. Wade ruling, paving the way
for just as wicked. Abortions. Well, if we're just as wicked, then why hasn't God done the same thing?
I didn't include it, but you remember that last goofball I fucking showed you?
Yeah.
He has an explanation for that. He said, you know, yeah, we're worse than Sodom and Gomorrah,
but... Oh, we're worse?
Yeah, we're worse, but... Here's the thing.
Jesus, right?
No. No. The reason that God hasn't done that is because he's already given us that warning. And he's cooking that up. God already knows the end times are near. So
oh, it's
no,
coming.
There's
oh, so
no,
no
point in him targeting it now because he knows he's going to get us in the end times anyway.
Oh, I got you. He's like, look, I'm going to get you later. I don't want you to do it now, but
in
look,
fact,
I got you.
If you look through the Bible, Sodom and Gomorrah is referenced quite a few times. And usually... almost every instance of it being mentioned is someone going to a city that's also wicked and saying, this city's just as evil as Sodom and Gomorrah, and God will also destroy it. So basically, God took out Sodom and Gomorrah as a warning to the other cities.
Right. Don't fuck around.
Yeah, don't fuck around because I got the power to destroy your shit.
Remember when Katrina hit, a lot of evangelicals said the same shit. They're like, "That's why do you think it hit New Orleans?
Because the gays."
Yep. I mean, and we've heard that shit over and over again. So you do, I guess you do see that parallel even in modern Christianity.
The fucking queers.
You know,
well, that's the point of me playing this shit.
So if someone were to ask 95-year-old, often bedridden, Billy Graham today, if Sodom and Gomorrah and the United States were equally wicked 52 years ago, which one is more wicked today?
Probably the one where the entire town shows up to rape some dudes.
Yeah, I was going to say, it's kind of hard to beat that. I don't know of any town.
Okay, let's just put it this way. The most righteous man in Sodom and Gomorrah offers his daughters up to be raped.
Yeah.
That's the bar we're dealing with.
Well, it's a nonsensical comparison, and I'll tell you exactly why. The U.S. is a majority Christian nation, especially going back to 1962, even more so. So you're talking about a land that has tons of Christians, tons of people who follow that doctrine. You're talking about, as compared to Sodom and Gomorrah, where no one besides one person
they're
followed that?
They're not true Christians, Scott.
Oh, they're not true Christians.
They're not true Christians.
Okay.
Every Christian recognizes maybe 2-5% of the other Christians around them as being genuine.
Right.
And think the rest are a bunch of posers, so that's just how that goes.
I'm one of the only real ones.
You know,
really,
a lot of people out there claim to be Christians, but they don't believe the right shit.
What do you suppose he might say? He might say that the United States is more wicked than Sodom and Gomorrah. Ouch. But think about it.
Ouch.
We have a president who is a Kenyan national who has never produced his long-form birth certificate.
Whoa.
Yeah, he goes there.
Promised change, and he delivered horrendous change of such radical immoral nature that we have already surpassed levels of socialism under a number of socialist regimes in the past, like Yugoslavia.
What?
Yep. I love how this just devolves.
The U.S. is had the same.
It starts dumb and just gets dumber as it goes.
So we went from Sodom and Gomorrah to we're basically a communist state to Obama did it, and the world is ending.
And with new laws making it a hate crime to speak out against homosexuality and other
sins. What laws?
In the Bible.
Yeah, there are no such laws.
You guys haven't seen the new laws?
Oh, the repeal of the First Amendment?
Yeah, new laws.
Oh, happened under Obama. I'm surprised you forgot.
It says better than Sodom and Gomorrah. As far as historic records record, Sodom and Gomorrah never went so far as to enshrine homosexuality into law.
The entire town. What?
I have a point of contention. You see, everybody in town showed up to rape two people and nobody stopped them. So there is no law regarding, like, it's just like it's encouraged. It's part of normal life in Sodom to butt rape people.
The de facto position at that point would be that the law does not, if Sodom and Gomorrah did not object to homosexuality, did not object to that in any way.
Yeah, so, who are we to tell them that they can't rape every fucking visitor, you know what I mean?
I mean, I guess if that's their culture, I mean, we can't really judge it, right?
Had some individuals engaging in homosexuality.
Some individuals? Every man in the town from every quarter of the town.
We just read it in the Bible. From every quarter came to say they wanted to know the angels.
So it's not just a few bad apples. That ain't going to work here. Sodom was rape crazy. They were just angel booty, thirsty fucking town.
These angels arrived that night, and every man, and men from every quarter of
through
the city.
Through word of mouth.
Yeah, spread like wildfire, showed up at the fucking right place at the right time to fuck these angels.
So I'm sorry. You really just can't go there. You just can't.
I think they can. I think he can. He's in his right to do so.
No.
And all the disparate things he tries to bring into Sodom and Gomorrah, to bring into this tale,
we were
too,
just talking about Yugoslavia 10 seconds ago.
They're just as bad as Yugoslavia.
Like, we got a Kenyan president who's never done long form and turn us into Yugoslavia. It's bad, and it's against the law to criticize homosexuality now.
We as a nation to limit our immorality to our own shores, we export the sewage of Hollywood worldwide. Not to mention demanding that other nations adopt evil laws.
So obviously this guy's a conservative, so he doesn't believe in the free market now, that the sewage of Hollywood, it's like, aren't they a business that you think should be allowed to operate? Oh, but wait, if you don't like the business, then it shouldn't be, because they're...
This guy doesn't strike me as much of a free market kind of guy. This strikes me as more of a social conservative.
Well, he was just saying that We basically became so socialist. So, I mean, I'm assuming he's probably more like a libertarian.
I would imagine he's probably more of a right-wing totalitarian sort of guy.
Well, maybe so.
Abortion rights. Rights? What about the rights of a baby? In order to get such purposes, United States aid and birth control, etc., or they don't get our millions of dollars.
Etc.
Agree to our kinds of birth
control. Etc.
Not to mention, we keep pressuring Israel to give up God-given land to terrorists.
God-given.
God-given?
Yet again, if something's God-given, I want God to come down from heaven to give it.
Hush. Yet we pride ourselves in being a quote-unquote godly nation? Sorry to say, that was yesterday, and yesterday is gone.
So he's good. One of these guys, like, except for you, though, right, buddy?
I'm still a Christian.
I've got it figured out, but the rest of y'all think you're godly? Let me tell you, you ain't.
Hell no.
It's so stupid, man. You hear this shit over and over again, and it's like, if you drive down any street in America, if you want proof that Christianity is alive in America, just look, see how many, count how many churches you see. Give me a fucking break.
They're all empty, though.
Not true Christians.
He's one of the most admired men nearly every year since 1955.
Billy Graham?
Admired by fucking retarded evangelical Christians, maybe.
By old ladies that stay up late and watching, like, telethons of his and shit.
And he has been heard in person or by way of media by over 2 billion people. His message
has
been
consistent
in his advice to the United States of America for the past 75 years, saying, quote, "I tell you, history could be altered and changed again if people went to their knees in believing prayer." Unquote.
Yeah, altered for the fucking worse, dude.
Let's pray for spiritual revival in America and help return a nation to its once.
I love Christianity. You know what? Because it's like it gives you this list of shit, like, action needs to happen. Action, look at all this shit we're doing. Look at all this shit going on. You know what we need to do? Pray.
How can we achieve
like
that?
The end goal is just whatever. Just get on your knees.
Everybody
and talk to yourself
whisper
for a while.
Into your fucking hands.
That's why I love fucking prayer rallies, dude. All these people are gonna get into a room and they're gonna pray. It's like, won't they actually get on their off their fucking knees and do something? If they really want to make effect change in the society they live in.
I mean, honestly, let them have it. Let them fucking think that they're doing something when they fucking...
I just want them to do it in their fucking closets and in their bedrooms in privacy like they're supposed to.
All right, so let's take a look at the other side. Not the other side as in the reasonable side, but the other...
The reasonable side wouldn't believe any of this shit.
There's liberal Christians out there.
Oh, this is all allegory, right?
So, no, they got a different one for this one.
What's their spin?
Here's the liberal Christian spin on this story. Because obviously liberal Christians are they want to be accepting of gay people and all that stuff. So here's their interpretation.
The story has nothing to do with homosexuality. It's about hospitality. Most of the story leading up to this is about how Lot is such a wonderful guy for helping these angels out. Hospitality is huge in Jewish law. I'll add a link below for you to check out. It goes into detail about the Jewish views of hospitality. The men who want to rape the angels are anything but hospitable, and this makes God angry.
I don't know.
This is actually parallel.
That's a bit hospitable, you know?
Yeah. Hey, welcome to Sodom.
How about some
towns here to rape you? Come on. Hey, we want you to come back again.
They say this story has no, that there's no connection to homosexuality is just baffling. I mean, even if you argue the story isn't, the interpretation for the last, you know, thousands of years is that it is.
Right. The liberals are trying to dress up this story, but there's really, like, there's nothing to dress up.
It's a total
turd.
Yeah, no, sorry, this doesn't work. I mean, you can say hospitality is maybe a factor.
Of course it is.
You could bring into this, but you cannot dismiss the homosexuality connection. There's no way. I'm sorry. That's quite literally impossible.
Judges. The same thing basically happens to a Levite. He gets room and board from a nice servant. Then the servant's master wants to rape him because he's not okay with a Levite taking his food and shelter. The difference in the book of Judges is that rather than...
What the fuck is wrong with this dude's voice? Is this some kind of weird filter?
I think it's just shit audio, dude.
The male Levite getting raped, his female concubine is raped.
He sounds kind of like the voice you would expect to get the call from like a hacker that needs your help with something. You know what I mean? Listen, it's got that cybernetic kind of tinge to it.
Yeah, I see what you're saying, man. All right, so basically the hospitality. Here's the same guy. Here's another guy gonna make the same fucking point. So
sodomy is one of the most misleading words in the English language. To think that the story of Sodom and Gomorrah
is about homosexuality because it involves...
Holy shit, is he transforming into Nosferatu before our eyes?
What do you mean transforming into?
What the fuck is going on?
Nosferatu just grew a beard, that's all.
Hello, I'm here to interpret the Bible.
Sound most like the people. Count from Sesame Street. Dude.
One sodomite. Two.
Homosexuality is just the instrument of what the sodomites are doing. The real offense, what they're really doing, of course, is rape. And not only that, but rape of strangers. Sodom is a story about hospitality, which was one of the most central values in the ancient Near East and occurs over and over and over.
I mean, is that like saying like a dude getting butt raped doesn't deserve its own distinction? Because it's different.
Well, also, the point could have been made absent fucking butt rape and angels being fucking threatened. And also,
why didn't they try to rob the angels or something?
Also, how do you also dismiss the connection where it goes to with the rape of Lot rape as daughters raping him? I mean, where does that go? And also, God bargaining. Where's the hospitality element in that? These are all elements in the story that you're just totally ignoring.
If the story was about condemning rape... Then why does the righteous man from town offer his daughters up to be raped? Why do his daughters end up raping him?
Yeah.
You know, those actions are not condemned. So you can't say it's really about rape. The hospitality thing, I mean, maybe that's a fucking factor. The fact that there's a big angry mob, and the Bible even says, even the men. It's like, even the men, like, it fucking draws your attention to that, like, look, even the fucking men in this town wanted to rape that angel ass, you know? Ooh, everybody in town showing up, even the men showed up to rape this angel ass. Like, it specifically singles that out. Like, you mean to tell me there's no anti-homosexual sentiment there? I think there fucking clearly is.
I keep expecting this dude in the corner to use echolocation to snatch a mosquito out of the air or something.
Dozens of biblical citations about the importance of hospitality and how evil the Sodomites were.
It's just a typical shit. It's let's use the Bible to prove the Bible is right. And, you know, it all ultimately comes down to interpretation. Yeah, you can interpret the Bible this way. But if you want to look at the popular interpretation for the last 2,000 plus years about this story, what most people interpret it as is that's not the interpretation. The interpretation is this condemns homosexuality and sodomy. And shows that you should always put God above any other interest in your life because that ultimately is the most important thing for you to do.
I love that.
If you wish to have everlasting life, you have to know God and do what he says.
I just love that there's these people with these very modern values and they're looking at a book that's totally antithetical to those values and trying to distort it and twist it into something that is in line with their values. So everything has to be reinterpreted through this lens and... You just twist it to hell. And I mean, like, I get it. The conservatives do that too. But man, the liberal Christians, they really have their work cut out for them making this into some sort of liberal progressive fucking book.
It's against rape. It's an anti-rape story.
Of course they have to do mental gymnastics.
It's all about hospitality.
That'd be like us taking, we covered Caligula. That'd be like us taking Roman laws and trying to justify them in modern times and say, well, we're going to use Roman laws the basis for our modern law.
No, it would be like looking at the story of Caligula and trying to make him the nice guy.
Yeah.
Trying to come up with an interpretation where he's the good guy and all that.
Yeah, when he, you know, made people watch their children be... executed. He was just giving them an opportunity to speak to their child up until the last moment of their death. What a nice fucking guy Caligula was for giving them, because oftentimes in Rome, people were not given the option to speak to their loved one before
and it
they
gives
were
them closure, you know?
Yeah.
What I'm saying though with the comparison with the laws, I'm saying you're taking
bitch.
You're taking these laws that we probably would find barbaric like slavery and saying, well, hey, it was okay. And that's even in the Bible too. Slavery was okay in those times, so let's just do that. You know, you can't justify some things with modern sensibilities no matter how hard you try. And I mean, look, people can try to be apologists for Christianity or whatever religion you want, but But we all know, I think people should decide right from wrong on their own. It's like, that's why we say it's subjective. You should use a rational, skeptical worldview and say, what do I feel is right based upon what I can reason out and what I can see, you know, based upon my sense of reality.
Well, you do what you want to do, hippie, but I'm going to rape my daughters if it comes down to it, okay?
Or offer them up to be raped by angry mobs to protect angels.
Yep.
So today's episode, a lot of incest. A lot of
drugs.
A lot of weird sex.
Yeah.
Assassinations.
Yeah. Murder, death, destruction on a massive scale.
Truly, the
loss of life.
I hope it was the double dose of debauchery that I promised you at the beginning. If you have any ideas for topics for this show, let us know.
Yes.
We're going to be launching our Patreon next Monday when we do our Monday show. Hope you guys tune in and enjoy that. If you're not subscribed to this channel and you enjoyed this episode, be sure to hit the subscribe, hit the fucking alerts.
And if you're listening on iTunes or some other place, just follow us on there. We're going to try to put this out. We're submitted to iTunes. We're submitted to Stitcher. We're submitted to a bunch of sites. We're going to be on SoundCloud, so there's going to be a lot of places to find us if you just don't want to watch or you just want to bring us with you on the road or wherever you're at. So
no. No, Scotty. Quit lying about shit.
I'm sorry. Okay, I guess I'm lying about us being all those places.
Why are you such a fucking liar,
Scotty? Actually,
we'll
fuck... You know what, TJ? I'll fucking sue you, you piece of shit.
Scotty? I don't mean to be rude, but you're a lying sack of shit.
I'm gonna fucking sue you, TJ.
You're a lying sack of shit, Scotty.
You're sued.
Consider yourself sued.
Deep Bad Freud. Deep Bad Freud. Deep Bad Freud.